everyone in this very particular session. I think I am not finding my coach, Dr. Sarajit Singh. Moreover, the reporter of the session, Ms. Napinder Kaur, is there. So,
so yes.
Yeah, in this session, we are having around about 12 papers. But before we start with, I would like to have your presence, that at least how many presenters are there, so that accordingly we can divide our time and for the presentations as such. So for that, I would just like to see that how we could go for it. So ultimately, we have now 10:45 and 10:45 till we would go up to 1 p.m. I think, or Napinder, can you confirm it? This session is up to what time?
Sir, it's up to 1 p.m.
It's up to 1 p.m.
So, yes.
So, it means, let us see.
Sir, your voice is not clear.
Hello, you are getting me?
Yeah, now.
Yeah. So, in that way, let us see that how many presenters are being there in this very particular session. The first is M.S. Sadiq and I.P. Singh, Ahmed M.M. Are they present here? Then we have second, the terms of trade and balance of trade of Indian agriculture sector during pre-post WTO period. Kavita, V.P. Kavita, Mehta, Raj Kumar, Daleep Kumar, Vishnoi, anyone among them available? No. Then we have the third paper is study of production and marketing of onion in new district of Haryana. Raj Kumar, Ashok Dhillon, Nirmal Kumar and Kavita. Now, then status impact and factor determining rural non-farm economy of India, a review. Ragya Deep Das, Raju, R. Neelam, Madhav Patnaik. No. Then next is a study of socioeconomic profile of rural poor with reference to SC and STs, marginalized section, evidence from Buldhana, district of Maharashtra state, K.D. Langte. No. Then we have rice production in Punjab, depletion of water resources and environmental problems. Jaswinder Kaur?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Jaswinder is there.
Yes, sir.
Changing role of agriculture in income and employment, trends of agricultural worker productivity in Indian state. Jaspal Singh, Tanima Datta, Anupama Rawat, and Nirmal Singh.
Yes, sir, I'm there, Tanima.
Tanima is there.
Yes, sir.
Then an epitome of organic agriculture in northeastern India, a way forward for the sustainable future. Priyanka Lal, I think she was there earlier. Priyanka Lal, B.S. Chandel, Binita Kumari, and Tulika Kumari. Anyone? No? I think Priyanka Lal joined and then left. Then there is a growth and economic profitability of castor cultivation in the semi-arid zone of Haryana. Nirmal Kumar, Neeraj Pawar, D.P. Malik, Sumit, and Daleep Kumar Bishnoi. No? Then we have changing composition and growth performance of services sector in India after liberalization. H.P. Gupta and Amreen Noor.
Yes, sir. I'm Amreen.
I'm here. Amreen Noor is
yes, sir.
There?
Yes, sir. I'm there.
Okay.
Yes.
Then the study of infrastructure facilities and farmers' awareness about the functioning of regulated markets in APMC, Kullu and Lahul Spiti.
Yes, Sheldon, sir. I'm here.
Isha is there.
Yes, sir.
Then last we have organic agribusiness in India, status, potential and constraints. Pillai, Yamuna, Ravindran and S.S. Kalamkar.
Yes, sir, I'm here. Yamuna is here.
Yamuna is here. Okay, it means we are having for the time being five papers, and I hope that the other presenters may be joining us very soon. Before I start with it, I would request you people to just mute your speakers, because your speakers will have extra sound and it would disturb the audio of other listeners as such. So, David Lante, you are also present?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I am there.
So try to be very specific so far as your presentations are concerned. I expect that you should go for your topics and what sort of objectives you have, how far is your very brief about the methodology, and then what are your findings, what you want to contribute in that way. Keep in mind your time is into 10 minutes. Try to finish with 10 minutes so that we can have some time for discussions also. And I hope that a few of other participants who could not join till now may also be joining in that way. So first of all, I take this opportunity to invite Katie Lente on the study of socioeconomic profile of rural poor with special reference to SCST, marginalized section, evidence from Buldhana district of Maharashtra state. Please.
Doctor, am I audible? Hello?
Yeah, yeah.
Sir?
Yeah,
am I audible?
Increase your volume. Be close to your mic.
My PPT is visible now, sir?
Go to the share screen, then the PDF, your PPT would be there.
Hey. Hello, sir.
Yeah, that is there.
PPT is clear now?
Yeah, yeah, you start now.
Okay, good morning to you all. Respected Chairperson Dr. Jasbir
Singh, sir. Ma'am, Jasbir Singh.
And Coach Chairperson Dr. Sarabjit Singh, sir.
Haanji, ma'am,
and all the participants who are here. My topic of research is socioeconomic profile of rural poor with special reference to SCST marginalized section for Buldhana district in Maharashtra. So I will begin with the introduction. Socioeconomic profile is a significant aspect in the social development theories in all underprivileged welfare state, including India. In Indian context, there are evidences of attempts made to analyze empirically convergence of divergence of social inclusion. In Indian states, there is a still shortage of basic amenities in the various states as far as flagship programs are concerned. The vision document of 12-5-year plan states that transform IOI, that is Indira Awas Yojana, into a larger habitat development program. We need sanitation, clean fuel, electricity with housing. This calls for deeper convergence across various flagship programs. It was observed from the various previous studies, there is a major weakness in the economy. It shows that growth is not perceived as being significantly inclusive for many groups, especially SC, ST and minorities who are below poverty line, that is BPL. Hence, the present study is focusing on the dynamics of socio-economic development and social convergence of rural poor in Buldhana district. The methodology for this research, the Buldhana district from Vidarbha region of Maharashtra state was purposely selected. Then the maker Jalgaon Jamot Tehsil was chosen on the basis of highest number of SC, ST and BPL households. Then the villages or Gram Panchayat was selected on the basis of highest number of IOI beneficiaries. Then the IOI beneficiaries were selected randomly where the 100% housing construction has been completed up to the May 2018. The 200 IOI beneficiaries randomly selected for the study from the selected villages of the study. And we have collected the primary data from the field for 200 samples. The key, as far as the key parameters of the study is concerned, we have selected the parameters like income of the beneficiary household, years of the education, employment status, expenditure on consumption, their family sizes, their ownership of the land, their ownership of the assets, then health facility score of the respondent. During this research, we have computed the asset score. The asset score of each household is computed by taking into account assets such as livestock, motorcycle, tractor, truck, mobile phones, etc. Equal weightage was given to the assets in each category to make a composite index of the asset budget. Second, we have computed health facility score. It was we have computed health facility score by taking facilities like drinking water, drainage, latrine, then ventilation, benefits of the health scheme, access to health facility. Equal weightage is given to facilities in each category, and on the basis of that, this health facility score was computed. As far as the primary data is concerned, it was found that around 35% respondents found to be illiterate, around 28% landless laborers were there. The majority of them were in the monthly income group of rupees 5,000 to 10,000, that is 95% people. And finally, we found that 49% people or respondents were in the slab of rupees 2,500 monthly expenditure. In this research, we have used the research tools like correlation analysis, then paired sample t-test, the simple linear regression analysis, and multiple regression analysis. First of all, I will focus on the paired sample correlation analysis. This paired sample correlation analysis was conducted to examine the relationship between the total income of family and health facility score, the health facility score with the family size of education of husband and spouse in the study area. It was found that health facility score is positively correlated to education, and total member of family and education of husband and spouse are negatively correlated with the health facility score in study area for SCST respondents. That means if education is high, health facility score was higher. On the other hand, if the total member of the family is more, then education and health facility score was lower in study area. Then this correlation was significant at p value 0.001. And the next tool was used, that is paired sample t-test analysis, and it was observed from this result of paired sample t-test analysis. Paired sample t-test, the means of the level of income and the health facility score of family was significantly higher than the total member of family and education of households in the sample area. Hence, this finding supports that the total income of the family and the health facility score is more effective than the total member of family and education of SCST respondents. So it is the t value, you can see the health income and health facility score for SC/ST, the key value is 14.62%, and the member of family of education of SC/ST, that is key value is 8.59%, as both the tests are statistically significant at key value of 0.001. Then next step is we have conducted the simple linear regression. The simple linear regression results, the result of simple linear regression indicates that the predictor variable, that is log of income, was found to be statistically significant, which means every 1% increase in income, asset score increases by 0.239, as indicated by the G value, which means every 1% increase in independent changes by 0.239 units in the study area. So the log of income is more effective in study area. Then we have conducted the multiple regression analysis to see which independent factor is more effective in study area as far as asset score is concerned. The result of the multiple regression revealed that a statistical significant association between log of income, education, and total member of the family. But the log of income is more effective than the education and total family member as far as asset score of concern in the study area regarding the SC/ST population is concerned. So, finally, we found that the findings of the study, the peer sample correlation found that health facility score is positively correlated with education. Higher the education, higher the health facility score. It is also noted that more member of family and education, family member and the education of family are negatively correlated with health score. So higher the member of the family, lower will be the health score. That is also found in the study area. Then the result of peer sample t-test supports that the income of the family and health score are more effective than the total member of family and education of house husband and spouse in the study area. So income is more significant factor as far as the asset score is concerned, rather than the education of the husband and spouse in study area. Then the result of simple linear regression analysis indicates that every 1% increase in income, the asset score changes by 239% in study area. So income is a very effective factor as far as asset is the core. And then finally, we found the result of multiple regression analysis revealed that there is a significant association between asset score and log of income, education, and total family member of study area at p value which is lesser than 0.001, but ultimately income is a more effective factor as far as asset score of as far as the asset score is concerned in study area. Thank you sir.
Mr. Jasveer, unmute your mic. Dr. Jasveer, unmute your mic, please.
Thank you. Good presentation, Lady Lange. So far as your presentation is concerned, it's concerned with the secondary as well as...
Your voice is not clear, sir.
I would request, so far as our presenters are concerned, be in the session, because at the end we may have discussions and question answer sessions. Okay. So far as our next presentation is concerned, Mr. Aragya Deep, I am just looking at the screen.
Yes,
you
sir.
Have joined.
Yes, sir.
Are you ready for with your presentation?
Yes, sir.
That is Status Impact and Factor Determining Rural Non-Farm Economy of India, a review. Please go ahead.
Sir, sir, there is a problem. I cannot share my screen.
You don't have PPT?
Yes, sir, I have PPT.
Go on share screen.
But sir, option is showing that you cannot start screen share while the other participant is sharing.
Kailash Langte.
Is it visible, sir, my slides?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Okay, good morning, everyone. Myself, Hadid Das. I'm going to present a review article which is based on status, impact, and factor determining dual non-farm economy of India. First, we need to understand what is the current status of rural non-farm economy. We know that 70% of the population resides in rural area, and increasing the dependence of small and marginal farmers over land make the land unsustainable to meet food requirements.
Mr. Das, be loud bit. Put mic near to your mouth. Yeah.
Okay. Okay, sir. Now I'm audible. Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Okay. So we know that
you are not audible.
Hello, sir. Now I am audible. Hello.
Yeah.
No, fine. Okay. So we know that 70% of the population of our population resides in rural area, and as increasing our dependency of small and marginal farmers over land, it makes the land unsustainable to meet the food requirement for both house and cattle. The co-worker in the study had shown that non-farm income diversification in China had been found to reduce income inequality and poverty. According to Ranganathan and his co-worker, non-farm activity will not only help in decreasing pressure on land, but also increase per capita income of rural household. Thus, this study was conducted to understand the impact of rural non-farm economy on rural livelihood and the factors determining it. Now we need to understand what is the current status of non-farm economy in our country. According to Shah and Barak in the year 2016, they found that proportion of rural workers in non-farm activities increased from 35% in 1999 and 2000 to 40% in 2011-12. Basla and his co-worker conducted a study toward different states of our country, and they found that GST per non-farm activity grew considerably in 2000, especially in Andhra Pradesh, Haryana, Gujarat, Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu, and Karnataka. And among the major non-farm activities, Bihar and Mitra found that 44.77% were engaged in salaried job, followed by self-employment and non-farm wage labor. And within the self-employment, 69% was engaged in trade and businesses. Now, this chart was presented by Chand and his co-worker in 2017. This chart shows that in 1971 to 1994, agriculture growth rate was 2.57, whereas non-agricultural growth rate was 5.70. But during liberalization time, agriculture growth rate was 1.87 and non-agriculture growth rate was 7.93, which depicts that with the manufacturing, construction, and service sector, non-agriculture sector also the main contributor for the boosting of economy during that time. If we see through the employment status, we can see that except the construction sector, all the other sector has showed decreasing or constant growth rate during 2005 to 2012. And within this manufacturing sector, wiring capital, tobacco product, textile, non-metallic mineral product, and food and beverages had generated major share of employment, in 2011 and 12. Few studies were also collected for understand the disaggregation on farm employment. Nandini and Kiresur conducted their studies in Karnataka, and they found that non-farm wage within the male counterpart, employment was mainly generated from non-farm wage, which is 15.2% for PT business and efficiency. But whereas in case of female counterpart, major employment was generated in, through crop production and PT businesses, followed by crop production and dairy, and non-farm and farm wage employment, and also non-farm wage employment. Bitsal in his co-worker in 2014 found that Asian household had less access to non-farm business activities because of the limited skill and barrier faced in accessing finances for starting non-farm businesses. However, there is a contradiction in this study, as Bhuyan and Mitra conducted the studies in Assam, and they found that 60% income of ST coming from non-farm activities, whereas major portion of income for ST come from agriculture activity, salaried job, and third major source of income was for them was salaried jobs only. these graphs show that there is a U-shaped relationship between size of landholding and percentage of people engaged in non-farm activities. This relationship was found because as the marginal farmer landholding was less than 1 hectare, they found agriculture activities unprofitable. That's why they moved to non-agricultural part, especially in low-skill jobs like petty businesses, etc. And in case of large farmers where landholding activities 1 to 4 hectares, they found that their livelihood can be sustained through different skill-based oriented jobs like salary job or services. That's why we can see that there is a usual relationship between land of science holding and percentage population engaged in non-farm activities. Now we need to understand what is the impact of non-farm activities on different poverty and inequality. Throughout and Shuri conducted a study in 2018 on Maharashtra and found that compared to households employed in agriculture, self-employment in non-agriculture tend to invest more in assets, indicating a constant flow of income with later household, which is non-agricultural household engaged in non-agricultural part, irrespective of prevailing risk event. According to Revelia 2000, they found that growth of rural per capita non-agriculture output would have a significant impact in reducing rural poverty if growth exceeds its usual trend. However, there is a catch, as Chada and Sen has found that rising non-agriculture income could also increase inequality, as more well-endowed benefit more than poor agricultural groups. Hazel and Hegbert has put forward agricultural linkage theory, and Bithal and his worker has supported this theory. According to this theory, growth of agriculture was likely to stimulate growth and development of rural non-farm economy. Bithal and his worker also found that along with land productivity, proportion of leased in land holding size had a negative impact on non-farm income. Hattai and his worker has found a mixed effect, as they found the land holding size had a negative influence on diversification of income, but after a threshold level, it exerts positive influence. However, this linkage theory was not supported by the study of Basant, Singh and Mina and his co-worker. There is a shocking revelation that which was found in the study of Nirmalan and Singh in 2017. They observed that with the improvement of non-farm employment opportunities, soil erosion and nutrient loss increased significantly, and farmers deployed negligible labor for conservation measures, a diversion of farm labor to non-farm employment provides higher return. So besides agricultural, besides factor related to agriculture, there are other factors also which are also influencing non-farm economy. And these are the few factors that had been listed. Jara, Singh and Harris found that rural transportation and electrification, and Sen has found development programs like public expenditure has a significant effect on rural employment opportunities. Mena and his co-worker found that factors like crop and rate of credit for crop and livestock, Veta and his co-worker found that farmer access to information has a negative influence on non-farm activities. Besides that, age, wealth, marital status, work effort, risk, and education has also the important determinant of rural non-farm employment. So here is the conclusion. For the last few years, growth rate of rural non-farm economy had higher growth rate on agriculture. The gross state domestic product for non-farm economy was highest in few states like Andhra Pradesh, Haryana, and Gujarat. Male workers are more engaged than female counterpart in non-farm activities. Rural non-farm economy has a positive impact on poverty and investment, but also in case of increasing inequality. A number of studies prove that linkage theory between non-farm economy and agricultural activities and public expenditure, age, wealth, education are the important determinant of rural non-farm employment. Thank you, sir, for listening. Any suggestions?
Unmute. Dr. Jasir, please unmute your mic.
Hello, sir.
You have taken care of time as such also. So
be there. We would have discussion later on. So now I invite Mr. Rajkumar. They are having joint paper on Ashok Dillo, Nirmal Kumar and Kavita. But so far as the title of paper is concerned, is study of production and marketing of onion in new district of Haryana. So, Mr. Rajkumar, are you online? Hello? Okay, then Ms. Jaswinder Kaur.
Yes, sir. Yeah, you are there. Present.
Your title is Rice Production in Punjab, Depletion of Water Sources and Environmental Problem. Please start with your presentation.
Okay, sir. Good morning, respected teachers and my dear friends. Today, my topic of presentation is Rice Production in Punjab, Depletion of Water Resources and Environment Problems. Punjab has emerged as an important rice producing state in the country. The state with 1.53% of the geographical area of the country produces more than 11% of the total rice production in the country. The production of rice in Punjab increased more than 10 times due to increase in area and yield. The growth of rice crop at a such a high rate over 20 years in Punjab is indeed a real phenomena in the history of agriculture development in the world. Due to extensive cultivation of the rice in Punjab, the state has been over-exploitation its groundwater more than its recharge. Most of the tubal-dominated district of the state witnessed the fall in the water table more than 20 to 30 centimeters per year. To dispose of the paddy straw, the farmers of Punjab generally opt for burning it. This practice of burning of paddy in Punjab, so the area under this crop increased to 29 lakh hectare, which is unsustainable in the long run. The area under rice in Punjab should be stabilized at 16 to 17 lakh hectare, and the remaining paddy area should be shifted to other crops like pulses, oil seeds, maize, fruits, vegetables, extra, to achieve the proper water balance. It is noticeable that in the Punjab, groundwater, which played very important role in the Green Revolution in 1960s and 70s, is growing by 20 to 30 centimeters per year. Water table is declining in 77% of the area of the state. A critical water table below 10 meter depth has reached in 28% area of the state. This my table shows that there is over-exploited and dark blocks in the terms of groundwater table in Punjab. Can we show my presentation, my slide, sir?
Go for share screen. There is a screen. Share screen. Click there.
Share screen.
In Amritsar, this table shows that in Jalandhar districts, all of it, the 10 development blocks, and in Sangrur, 11 blocks have become over-exploited, and 20 blocks are in dark zones in the state, which is the mainly the result of high-intensive agriculture, that is rice wheat system. One of the major concerns often voiced is that increase in the area under rice in Punjab, the major water-consuming crop. The central part of the state, which is the rice belt, 100% irrigated, extensively used its groundwater. Over the years, the canal water from these sub-regions has also been diverted to the West Punjab, where the groundwater is unfit for the agriculture. Besides this, there is also environmental problems. For the rice crop, the farmers have to keep the water standing continuously in the crop field for 2 weeks. After the transplanting, so that the seedling get proper established. The standing water in the rice field during summer in the month of July and August has increased the humidity, which favor the pest incidence. This increase of pest infestation between these 2 months has forced the farmers to use higher doses of insecticides and pesticides. As a result, the cost of production increases, as well as it polluted the environment. Surface source like irrigation and use of fertilizers or pesticides also contribute to increase in fluoride content in the water. A study published in the international journal, that is Exposure and Health, has found that the fluoride ranges from 0.60 to 5.07 mg per liter in the water samples taken from the 16 districts of Malwa region of Punjab. As per WHO standards, it should be not more than 5 mg per liter for human consumption. In Ludhiana, Rupnagar, Fatehgarh Sahib, Patiala, and Ferozpur districts, the fluoride was found above 3 mg per liter. The excessive nitrogen intake in water is also due to excessive use of nitrogen-based fertilizer by the farmers of Patti. Fazilka, Mansa, Barnala, Muksar, Sangrur are the worst affected districts where the presence of nitrogen was found more than the prescribed limit. So the only suggestion we have that there should be the diversification of cropping system. We should stabilize the area under rice in Punjab at 16 to 17 lakh hectares, and the remaining paddy area should be shifted to other crops which are requiring less water in order to achieve the proper water balance. The area under high value crops, that is fruits and vegetables, can at best be increased by another 4 lakh hectares in the next decade. Thus, the state has to plan diversification from paddy over another 8 lakh hectares. At present, available alternatives are oilseeds, maize, agroforestry, fruits, vegetables. It may be mentioned here that at present we are deficit in pulses, oils, wood. So in order to meet our domestic requirements, Punjab is importing these products in large quantities. This shift will also require less irrigation water, as these crops require only 1/6 of the water as compared to the rice. Obviously, the requirement of power to withdraw water by tube wells will be less. As a result, the power subsidy, which is more than ₹5,500 crore, will be reduced, which may improve the state's financial health also. Also, the Commission for Agriculture Cost and Price fixes the minimum support price for these crops. It is very essential that there should be effective mechanism and adequate arrangement so that the farmers should buy their commodities at the fixed minimum support price. In the past, farmers of Punjab have tried to shift these crops such as sugarcane, sunflower, potato, tomato, maize, but failed due to the market and price support. This diversification plan will succeed only if the state government, central government, and the farmers who are the stakeholders in this process act in the cooperative and unison way. So it may be mentioned that there is a need for the diversification of cropping system. So if there is any loss due to this diversification, other states like Rajasthan, Uttar Pradesh can fulfill it. States will make up the loss in paddy production in Punjab, if any, by reducing area to sustainable level, which has become must now in view of falling water table and deteriorating soil health.
Mr. Sundar, please wind up.
Anji, okay, thank you, sir.
It's okay. No,
Anji, yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Now I invite Anima Datta for her joint paper with Jaspal Singh, Anupama Rawat, and Nirmal Singh, Changing Role of Agriculture in Income and Employment and Trends of Agriculture Worker Productivity in Indian States.
Thank you, sir, for giving me this opportunity. So, with due permission from the chair and the co-chair, I'm presenting this paper on behalf of my co-authors, Dr. Jaspal Singh, consultant Niti Aayog, Professor Anupama Rawat, OSD, Government of Madhya Pradesh, Nirmal Singh, he's a research scholar in Barkatullah University. As my topic is visible on the screen, that's the changing role of agriculture in income and employment and trends of agricultural worker productivity in Indian states. The main objective of taking this theme while we started off was that a lot of papers and a lot of literature is available on the productivity of agriculture per se, that is in terms of the production, the area under production, and the product and the overall production and productivity. But there are very few papers which talk about the productivity of the workers in the agricultural area. So these are the objectives of our paper, that to analyze the spatial contribution of agriculture and allied sector to income and employment, measuring the agricultural worker productivity in all the states for the selected time period. The time period that has been taken is the time periods that we have taken. 2011-12 and 2017-18. And then convergence-divergence hypothesis has also been tested to see which way the states have been moving in terms of agricultural worker productivity. Now, moving to the next slide, we are talking about the data and the methodology here. So, as I said, the two time periods that we have are 2011-12 and 2017-18. The data has been collected from the various rounds of NSSO regarding their employment and unemployment. And when we took the agricultural worker, we took the cultivators and the labor, the casual labor that has been working in this area. And the contribution of agriculture and allied sector has been estimated using the GSVA, which has been taken from the MOSPI, that is your Ministry of Statistics and Planning Implementation. This is how we calculated the worker productivity of each state. We calculated for the two time periods. We have calculated them. And then the compound growth rate, that is your CAGR, was calculated, estimated with the exponential model for all the states in the two time periods that we have. So, these were the methodologies. Now, coming to the results of this paper that we have done. Now, the agricultural here, we saw that the northeastern states have been doing very well in these two time periods in terms of their contribution to agriculture, like in terms of the contribution of agriculture to income, employment, and also regards to worker productivity. So Arunachal Pradesh tops the list when it comes to the contribution of agriculture to the state gross value added. And Chhattisgarh tops in terms of employment. There are 10 states which have shown a positive increase in the contribution of agriculture to the state income. And there are 3 states which have shown a positive increase in terms of employment that has that is provided by agriculture. Now, this if we talk in terms of the developmental paradigms or in terms of the development theories, then it is good that the contribution, like if less of less people are dependent on agriculture, so that's a very good sign for the development of the area. But if you talk in terms of the contribution of agriculture to the income, then that shows which way the country has been going over the years. Now, Madhya Pradesh, Andhra Pradesh, Mizoram, Tripura have shown a significant increase in agricultural income. And then the developed states, developed in terms of agricultural production, like Punjab, Chhattisgarh, Uttar Pradesh, like these have been known as the traditional food baskets of the country. They have become stagnant over time. And as my previous speakers have talked about Punjab and the stagnation in the agricultural area of Punjab, Haryana though has been doing much better than Punjab has been. But yes, that is what our study came out with. Now, all the small states that are there have shown maximum growth in worker productivity barring Andhra Pradesh and Bihar. Now, Andhra Pradesh was not a surprise for us when we did the data because when we like worked on the data because Andhra Pradesh, the government of Andhra Pradesh has been coming out with a lot of policies and a lot of case studies have come in where they are developing agriculture in a very positive way. So Andhra Pradesh was not a surprise for us. Bihar was, yes, a surprise. And the reason when we went to the reasons behind that, so there has been a policy shift, there has been change in the type of products that have been grown. Bihar has contributed a lot in the growth of flowers. So horticulture has become like, they are that is contributing a lot there. And the Meghalaya and Meghalaya has shown the highest change in number of agricultural workers which have gone down now, which is a very good sign for any economy, as I had said before also, that if less number of people are dependent on the primary sector, then that is better for the thing. Now, this is where we like if we talk about the agricultural worker productivity, This is the quadrant map that we like. This is the quadrant that we took of all the states regarding the convergence divergence thing, and in terms of worker productivity. And if you just look at this this map, then you'll find that most of the states in the first quadrant are the ones which are agriculturally developed. Like you've got Punjab, you've got Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh, Gujarat, Haryana. Andaman and Nicobar Islands, Nagaland is there. These are small states. They have been working on there. And you can say they're also outliers because they do not, if you talk in a broader picture, then these states are not contributing much to the national income. Now, like an interesting fact is that the intercept of the regression equation has a negative value. So that means that there is a convergence. Like your alpha value has a negative, is a negative. So that has it shows that there is a convergence. But the R square value that came out was not it was not at all promising. It was just 8%. So that means the explanation was only taking place. So that's a very insignificant number that we got. Now, like as I was saying, the smaller states, like if you look at the third quadrant, you have those small states coming up, which did very well. Like Mizoram has shown a 22.1% growth. Meghalaya is again near about that. Nagaland is 18.3%. Sikkim, though Nagaland is in the first quadrant, Sikkim is 14.1%. Haryana is 11.8%. Andamans is 12.6%. Before I was talking about Andhra and Bihar. Andhra is 10.9% and Bihar is 9.1%. So yeah, so the labor intensity in Bihar has gone up very significantly. Now this is again the regional variation that we have seen. I would like to especially mention about Madhya Pradesh, because Madhya Pradesh is a state which has contributed, like it has shown a significant contribution towards the agricultural income. The labor, the employment in labor, like employment in terms of agriculture, that was also positive. It has received 5 Krishi Karman awards for the production of wheat. But when it comes to productivity, it is not it is in the second quadrant. So that is very, very interesting. Like just to go back here, so it is Madhya Pradesh is coming in the second quadrant. So that means that a lot of claims that were made by the government of Madhya Pradesh are not true, and there is a lot of disguised unemployment in Madhya Pradesh. So that means there is still a lot of potential there in terms of worker productivity. Is one state again which shows a very high worker productivity, and but the growth rate is very low. And then you have Maharashtra, Karnataka, Chhattisgarh, Himachal, Jammu and Kashmir, which have got low worker productivity and low growth rate. So it's both ways that is there. The northeastern states have got a higher worker productivity, higher growth rate, and this is mainly because of the policy changes that have been there, and the way that they have been, the government has been working, have shifted from jhoom cultivation to a more stabilized form of cultivation, doing a lot of horticulture, a lot of organic agriculture is being done in the northeastern states. So these have all contributed there. Now, this is, as I said, this is, was a map, via a map, we showed how the things are, the regional variations are there. The red portions or the, like, yeah, the reddish portion, the brick red, they are the low productivity wise, those low states. And then you have got yellow ones, which are medium, and the green ones are mostly concentrated in northeast. And then you've got Punjab and Haryana here. One minute more. Punjab and Haryana, I would like to just mention one thing, that a lot of worker productivity here is a bit difficult to calculate because they depend on migrant labors. So that is there. So in conclusion, the Green Revolution has done its bit, but we need a second Green Revolution. Madhya Pradesh needs, like, it's doing very well in terms of income earned, but again, the cost is a per worker cost is very high there. The northeastern states have done tremendously well. So worker productivity needs to be worked upon. And that should be the next, in terms of policy, that should be the, that should be how it should be done. And thank you for giving me this opportunity. And sorry for going overboard by a minute or so. Thank you.
Thank you, Tanima. A good presentation in the way that you try to cover up majority of the states in India, but we will comment later on, no problem. Now I invite Priyanka Lal, B.S. Dale, Banita Kumari, and Tulika Kumari, an epitome of organic agriculture in northeastern India, a way forward for a sustainable future. Do we have Priyanka Lal in attendance? She was there, I think. No, gone now. So next, I take this opportunity to invite Amreen Noor. Their paper is on changing composition on growth performance of services sector in India after liberalization.
Good morning, sir. For giving me this opportunity. Good morning to one and all. I am here for discussing.
Put your mic near to your mouth.
I am here for discussing my topic. 1 minute, sir. That is changing composition and growth performance of service sector in India after liberalization. Service sector is the key driver of India's economic growth and have significant contribution in India's gross value added in recent years, as modern technology has permitted new means of service across the boundaries. It is indispensable for economic development in any economy. It is considered as the fastest growing sector in world economy, particularly after economic liberalization of 1991. The present study analyzes the Indian service sector through examining its growth and contribution in the economy. This study confirms that it has a significant growth rate is higher than the growth of overall GVA. Under subsectors, real estate ownership of dwelling and professional is dominant. Data and methodology. The secondary data has been collected to estimate the result of service sector from the source of CSO from the period of 1990-91 to 2016-17. The whole period is divided into three slots. The service sector divided into subsector, trade in hotel, restaurant, repair services, transport, storage, communication, railway, financial services, real estate, professional services, public administration, defense and other services. The share of various subsectors has been calculated on current price, and the growth rate of subsector has been calculated on constant price of 2004 and 5. Under the present study, composition, trend, and growth rate has been estimated to describe the result. In addition to it, changing contribution of service sector in Indian economy has been collected, where share of given state of economy in service sector has been estimated along with its growth rate, annual growth rate was estimated with exponential model. Under the first table, decadal changing contribution of subsector or service sector in Indian economy has been analyzed, where during 1990-91, the percentage share of real estate, ownership of dwelling, professional services was high, stood at 12.25% in service sector, which was followed by trade, repair, hotel, and restaurant that was 8.25%, where major portion come from trade and repair, which stood at 7.54%. Some of the subsector activities are multidimensional, which being a part of industry and service sector as well, mainly information technology and construction. It is noteworthy that there is a continuous rise in the share of trade, repair, hotel, restaurant in 2000 and 2001. That was 9.42%. Further, it touched 11.46% in 2016 and 17. where major contribution occurred from trade and repair services, whereas real estate, ownership of dwelling, professional services has been increased substantially in 2000 and 2001, which is reached at 12.76% due to government liberalized policy measures. Due to hike in infrastructure, where it caused drastic change after opening to Indian economy, despite of phenomenal global integration, Indian real estate and construction was collapsed due to increasing cost of financing, especially after 2007, because of complicated and corrupt regulatory mechanism. However, Government of India has undertaken various reforms to India more to make India more attractive for investment under service sector, including trade and repair. The Indian Railway is one of the important pillars of India's infrastructure, and it is the world's largest government railway. Indian Railway significantly contributing the economic growth of country, and at the same time it is important for transporting coal, iron ore, raw material for manufacturing sector. Rail transport is interlinked with the growth of gross domestic product, particularly forward and backward linkages. The share of railway in the country's GVA, however, has been nearly constant at level of 1.53% in 1990-91. It declined in the next decade at 1.06% in 2000-2001. And it further declined during 2010-11, 0.78%. Later on, it marginally decreased, that reached at 0.77% during 2016-17. It is observed that under the study, the performance of railway has been affected due to lack of investment in proportion to its size and importance of the country. In the table 2, outlines recent trends on account of growth performance of subsector of service sector in Indian economy, and it shows compound annual growth rate of all subsectors during first phase. That is during a first phase. Now it is audible, sir. During first phase 1990-91, 2001-2000, communication and shifts related to broadcasting registered higher growth rate at the level of 16.05%, which was followed by other subsector, hotel and restaurant, that is 10.67%. However, this trend has been significantly changed during next decade, 2000-2001 to 2010-11, where highest compound annual growth rate has been marked in air transport at 15.21%, communication and related services both sharply declined and touched at 11.06%. Similar declining trend was noted under hotel, restaurant at 8.16%, and financial sector also slipped, which reached at 8.60%. On the contrary, storage has been increased sharply, which touched at 7.99%. Railway shows significant rise in compound annual growth rate, that is 7.83%. Besides that, public administration and defense registered constant compound annual growth rate, which stood at 6.49%. Further, in 2000-2011 to 2016-17, trend has been changed. Communication and related service shown highest CAGR and other service sectors as compared to previous year. Besides that, sudden downfall has been marked in storage growth, which was 3.51%, and public administration defense has been declined at 4.63%, and hotel restaurant that CAGR was evenly down and noted at 5.65% as compared with previous decade. However, overall growth rate of communication was high, stood at 13.93% increased. Furthermore, it is observed under the third table, the study that contribution of Chhattisgarh was high, which stood at 86.53% in 2011-12 and 88.85% in 2016-17. It was followed by Delhi in 2011-12 and 2016-17 at the level of 83.42% and 84.47%. However, 8.24% growth rate of service was registered. Although Andaman and Nicobar Island, Karnataka had significant increase in 2016-17. Manipur, Telangana was also increased significantly. On the contrary, Sikkim was at bottom with 28.82% in 2011-12 and 30.39% in 2016-17. Goa, Uttarakhand, Chhattisgarh, Madhya Pradesh, Gujarat, Arunachal Pradesh registered at less than 40% of the share of services. However, Haryana, Jharkhand, Odisha, Rajasthan, Uttarakhand, West Bengal have a strong growth in service sector in recent year. It is observed that only two states had negative growth, which declined in recent year. Madhya Pradesh stood at 39.06% in 2011 and 12, and 35.59% in 2016-17. Mizoram 59.43% in 2011 and 12, and 45.72% in 2016 and 17. The foregoing analysis bring out the fact of a state share in service, which revealed that growth rate of Chhattisgarh is due to providing a special emphasis on dominating subsector of services, and it's mostly preferred destination for technology, whereas Sikkim and Arunachal Pradesh, due to geographical and environmental condition developed, are high in horticulture and agriculture. Although tourism has emerged as a new profession and have different opportunities. Apart of that, in the wake of some challenges in the form of lack of infrastructure, recent crisis in the world market, foreign direct investment restrictions and outsourcing backlash are major limiting factors. Thank you so much for hearing me. These all from my side. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you. We will have detailed discussion later on. Now I take this opportunity to invite Isha Sharma. I think Isha is here.
Yes, sir. I'm here.
A study of infrastructure facilities and farmers' awareness about the functioning of regulated markets of APMC Kullu and Lahul Spiti.
Yes, sir. Is my screen visible?
With Shelja Kumari, Lau. Preet Singh and Surbhi Bansal. Please go ahead.
Yes, sir. Is my screen visible?
Yeah. Go ahead.
A very good afternoon, a very good morning to one and all present here. Today, I'll be presenting my topic, the study of infrastructure facilities and the farmer awareness about the functioning of regulated markets of APMC Kullu and Lahul Spiti in Himachal Pradesh. Now, as we all know that regulated markets have been developed in our country since the beginning of the 20th century for the sole purpose of removing inefficiencies and malpractices from the agricultural marketing in the country. Now, the agricultural marketing, it is not just a place where certain legal conditions are enforced, but it is also an economic center where adequate demand is built up for the sale of agricultural commodities. The advent of agricultural marketing then helped in mitigating the market handicaps of the producers at the wholesale assembling level. Now, Himachal Pradesh, it is an agrarian state, as more than 80% of the people, they dwell in the villages. Now, there's a Himachal Pradesh State Agriculture Marketing Board, which is catering to the needs of the farmers so that they get remunerative prices for their produce in the market. And so this board, it has set up 10 APMCs and more than 50 regulated markets in the state. And the consistent efforts are being made by the board to identify proper places for setting up collection centers at different areas in the state. Now, the development of the farm sector, it does not depend only on the advancement in the farm technology, but improvement in marketing infrastructures is also essential to ensure better returns to the farmer. Infrastructure comprises an arrangement of national assets which provide place, form and time utilities to the product and services. So these include like storage facilities, market yard, basic amenities, research and training institution, means of communication, etc. So the objectives of my study were to compare the marketing infrastructure across different marketing in the state in APMC, and to study the farmer awareness and perception regarding the impact of the market regulations in the marketing of the commodities. Now, my methodology. This study is based on the primary data, and out of the total 10 APMCs in the state, I selected APMC Kullu and Lahul Spiti, and under this APMC, there were 7 markets. Now, simple random sampling was used to select the sample, and the list of farmers was prepared, and out of the list, 60 farmers were interviewed. Now, I have studied the infrastructure development of the regulated markets through the Infrastructure Development Index, and to study the perception of the farmers towards the working of regulated market, Henry Garrett ranking technique was used. So marketing infrastructure facilities across the different APMC, in the different markets of APMC, Kullu and Lahol Spiti. These were the seven regulated markets under this APMC. And now I've studied the, I've divided this infrastructure into trade infrastructure and support infrastructure. The trade infrastructure included auction platform, packaging and grading, number of shops and stores and godowns. And support infrastructure included the farmer rest house, canteen, water supply, parking facilities, etc. So as we can see that the Bhuntar market, there's a regulated market named as Bhuntar, which was having the largest number of shops, that the highest number of shops, that is 21, followed by Kheksu market. And if you talk about the farmer's rest house, Bhuntar market was having the maximum number of farmer's rest house, that is 5, followed by Kullu, etc. And to study the market infrastructure in more detail, I've constructed the market infrastructure development index, which was divided into trade infrastructure and the support infrastructure. And the value of this infrastructure, it ranges between 0 and 1. And if the value comes as 1, it means that that market is fully developed. And so if the higher the value of this index, it means that the more developed is that particular market. So the results showed that the Bhuntar market was maximum developed, followed by the Patlipul market and the Kullu market. And the Bandrol market was least infrastructurally developed. Why? Because this was a seasonal market and there were no permanent sheds in the godown in particular, in this particular market. Next is the farmer awareness and perception regarding the working of regulated market. Out of the total farmers, 56.67% of the farmer were aware about the regulated market and 31.67% were partially aware, and only 11.67% were not aware of the about the regulated market. And almost all the respondents were stated that this regulated market was useful to them, and they were of the view that most of the farmers, they were aware, as well as they were of the opinion that regulated markets are useful for, to them. Now, what were the farm category-wise motivating factor to prefer the regulated markets? Now, there were many motivating factors which led the farmer to sell their produce in the market. And out of which it was found that the this market information was the main motivating factor due to which the farmer was selling their produce in this market, followed by infrastructure facilities that they were getting in the market, plus the prompt payment was also a major motivating factor. Next is the farm category wise ranking and working of the regulated markets of the selected APMC. For this, I have used the Garrett ranking technique. And in this, the farmers selling their produce at different regulated markets were asked to state the level of satisfaction towards working of regulated market. And an attempt was made to find out the relationship among the satisfaction level of the sample farmers and the working of the regulated markets of the state. So as you can see in the table, there are four functions, like physical functions related to the producer welfare, physical functions related to trade, facilitative functions related to prices, and facilitative functions. And now under these, each functions, five factors were considered, like physical functions related to producers' welfare were like provision of drinking water, rest house, toilet, parking facilities, and canteen. Under physical functions related to trade were grading, transportation, storage facilities, processing facilities. And then under the facilitative functions related to prices, they were price stability, price information, payment procedure, market information. And under different facilitative functions were like banking facility, pledging loan facility, etc. And so it was found, on the basis of the table, it was found that market physical functions related with the producer welfare were ranked as the first regarding the working of regulated market with the Garrett ranking score of 58.99%. It was followed by facilitative functions related with the prices and the other two. Therefore, it can be seen from the table that the response were highly satisfied with the physical functions related with the producer's welfare, like provision of drinking water, toilet, farmer's rest house, parking facilities, and the canteen facilities. So now the conclusions and the policy implications. On the basis of the infrastructure development index, Bhuntar market was found to be most developed, followed by Patlipul and the Kullu market. Whereas, as I've already told, Bandrol market was found least developed because this market was operational only during the peak season and there were no permanent sheds and the shops for the marketing of the produce. And regarding the working of regulated markets, farmers were highly satisfied with the physical functions related with the producer's welfare, like provision of drinking water and toilets, farmers shared canteen and parking facilities. And non-availability of infrastructure facility is a serious handicap for the smooth and efficient functioning of regulated market. And so the APMC Kullu and Lahol Spiti should come up with the necessary storage and other infrastructure facilities to avoid the market glut and the government should also frame the policies to create scientific storage facilities on large scale. This would go a long way in fetching remunerative prices to the farmers. Thank you.
Thank you, Visha, and I'm Dr. Sarvjit, and you have presented your paper, and may I know who is the next presenter?
I guess it's Yamuna, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. You're welcome. Yes, you can continue your presentation. Kindly, unmute your mic.
Audio. Yeah, am I?
Yeah, audio, yes.
Okay, thank you. This is Yamuna. Presenting my paper on our paper along with Dr. S.S. Kalamkar, Organic Agribusiness in India, Sales Potential and Chemistry. First and foremost, to start with, why organic? The organic agriculture system has come up in a large way owing to the adverse effects of conventional agricultural practices on human health, environment and sustainability. Apart from that, non-tariff trade barriers like sanitary and phytosanitary measures in the international market, and there is also a growing demand for organic products that far outstrip domestic supply. The global demand for organic food, which was just worth $54.9 billion in 2009, has almost doubled to $100 billion in 2018. The total area under organic cultivation crossed 70 million hectares, and 2.8 million organic farmers are associated with organic production worldwide. As far as the per capita consumption is concerned, Switzerland leads, followed by Denmark and Sweden. United States is the leading market, followed by Germany and France. Let us have a look at some of the major statistics of world organic agriculture. Australia, Argentina, and China are leading as far as countries with organic agriculture land and are concerned. And if we talk about the producers, India leads, followed by Uganda and Ethiopia. If we talk about the organically managed land the world over, the leader is Oceania, followed by Latin America and Europe. If we talk about the top 10 countries with the largest organic retail sales, it is again USA topping the chart. If we talk about the organic cultivation in India, then the data on 2018-19 shows that Maharashtra leads it with the top, being at the top, followed by Madhya Pradesh and Karnataka. The total area of the organic certification, Madhya Pradesh, followed by Rajasthan, Maharashtra, Chhattisgarh, and Uttar Pradesh. If we talk about which are the crops that India has comparative advantage, then we have a whole lot of crops like tea, spices, coffee, rice, wheat, cotton, sesame. Various studies have proven that there are various kind of crops that India has a comparative advantage in. If we talk about the total organic exports from India, then Madhya Pradesh top in terms of both quantity as well as value terms, followed by Gujarat in terms of quantity and Telangana in terms of value. Major export destinations are USA, followed by European Union and Canada. So what are the opportunities for organic producers in India? Various government policies like NPOS, the National Horticulture Mission, PKBY, RPBY are the enabling policy for organic agriculture for the Indian farm. Apart from that, India is blessed with a varied agro-economic zone, agrochemical zones, which has the potential to produce a wide variety of agriculture, horticulture, and medicinal crops. Another important point cited by Venkatesh Rulu in 2008 is that 50% of the cultivated area in India is grain-fed, and 30% rainfed farmers in remote areas are they never use chemical fertilizers. So India is organic by default. Animal husbandry is an integral part of Indian agriculture, which is very suitable for organic farming. The traditional farming system in India, which is grain-fed, uses very negligible amount of chemical fertilizers. But then there are certain challenges for the producer as well. Though the organic waste, the main problem is there is a sizable gap in the potential and realized use of organic waste in India, which has been cited in many studies. Lack of information on the side of the farmers, and on top of it, conflicting information and misconceptions regarding organic farming are stopping many farmers from moving towards organic. The high labor requirement of organic farming is also a very important, crucial impediment. The initial reduction in yield, how can farmers support them when they are converting from conventional to the organic practice? Non-availability of separate markets and the high cost of certification are also cited out to be another major problem for the farmers. Challenges for the organic agribusiness. Supply chain issues. Organic production involves high cost of production, which results in very few farmers opting for it, leading to quantity issues for the trader, retailer, processor, and exporter. Low shelf life. As no chemicals are used, the shelf life of organic produce many a time is very low, with product getting rotten very fast. Consumer doubt. Though the market demand for organic is increasing, even today, the consumer is not very aware of the organic, what is organic produce, what is natural produce. On top of it, there are various kinds of certifications, the Organic India label, the PGF label, which is arising consumer doubt. There is also mismatch between demand and supply. Consumers many times demand for fresh organic produce, which the retailers are very much not able to supply throughout the year. Lack of awareness. What are the opportunities in organic agribusiness? The FSSAI regulation in 2017 brought a greater credibility to the Indian organic market. It is compulsory under this regulation to follow the provision of NPOP, PGS, India, or any other standards of FSSAI. Increasing demand in the domestic and foreign markets. With a rising disposable income of the Indian consumers, the domestic demand has been increasing. At the same time, there has been increasing demand in the foreign market as well. According to the study of 2018, owing to the exponential growth in the organic food market, a sizable number of investors were investing in organic food companies. Online marketing and social media platforms is also a very great opportunity for those involved in organic agribusiness. Health awareness and rising disposable income is increasing the demand for organic food in India. Organic companies are coming up with newer varieties of food, drinks, baby foods, energy bars, and health supplements, creating a new market for urban organic consumers. So I conclude by saying that India does have inherent strength in the production and marketing of organic produce owing to varied agroclimatic zones. There is a large number of organic producers in the world, and India is ninth in terms of area under organic cultivation. Encouraging organic agriculture would require appropriate government policies to address the problem of supply and demand uncertainty, appropriate processing technology, cost of certification, and inspection and market development. India does have the potential to be a world leader in the organic produce. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Pulayamna. Now we can next presenter to present the paper. I'll request this Dr. Jasmeet, please continue this.
Thank you. Sorry, I was missing in between because of power failure. We have one more presenter, Raj Kumar. Is he here again because he missed his chance earlier? Rajkumar, are you there? A study of production and marketing of onion in new district of Haryana. Sarjeet, are you getting my...
I'm getting your voice, yes. It's audible, sir.
So Rajkumar, is he on your... Yeah, Rajkumar, is he there on your screen?
No.
Rajkumar?
No, he's not. No.
Any presenter who is left now? Any presenter who is left? Okay, friends. We have a very good session and good presentations were being here. So there were 12 presentations in the state. But we missed three presentations. I am happy to note here that so far as this session is concerned, before concluding and giving my remarks and opening this session for question answer, would you please, Dr. Sarvjit, say a few words as a co-chair?
Okay, I have, yes. Definitely. So sorry, I late entered due to technical error, and I have seen some papers and different paper presented by the presenters on the different issues, and they have been included here, and they discuss something about. I have seen the paper like this year by Tanima Datta, that is on agriculture, and one is the this rice production in the Punjab, depletion of water. So before starting any, I have some query. I request this question Singh, please you can call for the question and discuss on the papers.
Okay. So dear participants, now the session is open for discussion. Any query, discussion, any clarity from the these very particular presentations, if you want to have. You can ask. It's open for no discussion.
So let me start from my side.
Sure.
I have just one. I was just queried. I would like to ask from. Tanima Datta, that is related to what are the reasons that why there was a double digit growth in agricultural productivity in some states? What are the reasons of that?
Hi Sarabjit, thank you for listening to the paper so well. The main reason that we found in the double digit growths were mainly in the northeastern states, where you know the developmental theories and growth theories have always been saying that like it's also there in the convergence theories that taking from the solo model, that the states or the districts which are lying behind initially in the development process, when the development process starts in those areas, it outpaces the other regions. And that is what has happened in northeastern regions, because northeastern regions had a very different type of agricultural production. Like they were doing jhoom cultivation, and it was like because it's a more tribal dominated area, so there was shifting agriculture. Now they have done it in a more organized manner, in a more stabilized manner, so that is helping. And the government policies have been tremendous there. Like if you look at the policy initiatives that have been taken by the government, they have been very well. The same has happened in Bihar, because Bihar was a very surprising element for us while we were doing it, because we checked and cross-checked Bihar, because Bihar has always been known to be lagging behind. So when we checked there again, the government policies there have been very well, and the intensity of labor has gone up very highly in Bihar. AP, again, they have brought in like the technological intervention has been very good in Andhra Pradesh. So that is the case. Madhya Pradesh, the Malwa region has done wonderfully well there. So there like wheat and soya bean has been the main like areas because of which Madhya Pradesh has done so well. So these are the main reasons for which we saw that double-digit growth.
And what about the agriculture productivity liberty of Punjab?
Punjab has been, the productivity has become stagnant. Like, you know that there has been n number of papers. Yesterday I was reading an article by Gill sir, Sucha Singh Gill sir, and there again he has talked about how it has been become constant, because you know I suppose one of the ladies here, she was talking about paddy cultivation and how that has become. So the decrease in the water levels has acted very worse. You are just, it's like you're just doing wheat and paddy in and out. So that needs a change. And somehow I think so, like Punjab has done very well in terms of like food processing industries. There are certain industries which are doing very well. So if that forward linkage, because backward linkages in Punjab are very well established, the forward linkages are not there. So I suppose there is something that needs to be done. And you also have the problem of migrant labors, like, because you have got Bihar and UP labor working the main here. So labor productivity there becomes an issue, because which state to count them in? Do you count them in Punjab or do you count them in UP and Bihar? So that becomes an issue for us. So, that is about Punjab.
Okay, thank you. Now, Professor Jasveer, please, you can. Dr. Jasveer, your voice is
not... Sorry, sir, you are not audible.
Voice is not clear.
Hello.
No, sir. Hello. No, it's not. Now it's clear. Yes.
Okay. So so far as these presentations are concerned, I think paper by K.D. Lengde is also a very interesting paper, where he has tried to cover that very particular marginalized section and supporting the evidences from. So far as the field data are concerned, it has highlighted that how it would be that so far as the socioeconomic profiles are concerned, with reference to these marginalized sections in the rural area, how these have been having effect. So far as the paper by Jaswinder Kaur is concerned, I think she has highlighted very important, and since long we are dealing with, I would say, facing with the problem of depletion of water so far as Punjab state is concerned, that too in the cultivation of rice crop is concerned. But very finally, she has also attempted to take on the quality of water, which we have to see that how state would be able to take control or contain these type of things as such. So far as a paper by Armeen Noor is concerned, that is very wonderful paper, where she has tried to take on service sector, that too with the secondary data. She has tried to cover up that how these service sectors, when they are being divided into subsectors, how these are going to have, I would say that particularly as a Tanya was also mentioning about that the recent situation which has cropped up in the country, that how already suffering this very particular sector because of lack of financial support. In particular, I would say the hotel industry, how they would act now after COVID situation. I know that this is going to have long-term effect, but very good attempt has been made. I would suggest her and her co-author that whenever they work on it, they should extend a bit so far as the time period is concerned, so that this impact can also be seen. So far as infrastructure, facilities and farmer awareness is concerned, though I could not listen because of the technical fault full paper, but so far as conclusions and his PPTs were concerned, I think she has tried to take on so far as the hilly areas are concerned, how they are being there with regard to what sort of crop infrastructure or the marketing infrastructure has been created. So with regard to this very particular agribusiness is concerned, Yamuna has made, she has made very good attempt in her presentation as such. So with regard to, I would like to deliberately I kept in the last over as the Tanima Datta's and others' paper is concerned. She has talked about, as Dr. Sarabji, you are also mentioning out, but I have to say that Tanima, you have talked about so far as the productivity and the growth rates are concerned. You talked about the low productivity and low growth rate, and higher productivity in that way may lead to higher growth rate. And you have given very good picture, and I think very positive and present picture about the smaller states are concerned. But I have to see whether you have taken into consideration the other exogenous factors also when you talk about productivity or the labor productivity in particular agriculture or working in rural area. That has, I think that has to be there, that when you talk about or whenever we want to generalize whole of the situation or whole of the study. So attempt should be there, because it's very fine, because
no problem, sir.
Sir, we have lost you.
Voice is not clear, sir. It's
very good, but those dimensions should also have been highlighted. Overall, very good presentations. I'm very thankful to organizers, particularly Charles Saab and my co-chairperson, Dr. Sarabjit Singh, reporter of the session, Ms. Napinder Kaur, and all other people who are there taking this effort to organize such type of interactions through webinars and interactions. I know it very well now, this for a quite long period of time, this is going to be the system where academicians and researchers have to interact. But I congratulate this very particular Department of Economics, Head Department of Economics, Professor Balwinder Singh Tiwana, and Society and Development Ludhiana. I am happy to be part of this interaction, and it is, I think, for the first time I'm getting associated with them. I would love to interact with them. I would love to share my own research and them in the future. Looking forward to more interactions and more such opportunity. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. And thanks. I'm also thankful to the Professor Shahal and the team for this. And so, okay. So we are now ending this session. And thank you very much. Thanks.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.